So before we show the regret we get by this algorithm, follow the regret, follow the leader, we are just going to show that the regret whatever we had is can be bounded in terms of this loss function observed at two consecutive predictions. So just me make that formal, that is lemma. And I'm also going to write it as this is a FTL policy, and also I'm going to use a reference one U. This is given as FT1 N. See, like when I looked earlier at the regret, I had a in minimum over all u, right? Right now I'm not looking at all u, but I'm looking at one particular u. This loss is computed at one. So this is just saying that if I'm going to apply throughout all the rounds one u always, this is the loss I'm going to get. I'm going to compare this loss with whatever the loss you are going to incur by your algorithm. So this is the loss you are going to incur, right? So W1, WTs are the ones selected by your algorithm. We are going to argue that this guy is upper bounded by this quantity, which is at every point at every t we are basically looking at f of t w minus f of t computed at WT plus 1. Yeah, it is the next. So if t is at WT is the one selected in round t, WT plus 1 is selected in the next round. Okay, so we have basically represented everything in terms of the difference between FT function computed at WT and WT plus 1. So this is basically the major step in this. After that it will be easier for us to show, depending on what function FT is, the regret bound on this. We are going to show this. Okay. So we want to show this. Showing this is same as showing, like if see the first term is going to be the same in both of these. So showing this is same as I want to show that this regret is going to be showing same as I want to show that t equals to. So if I am going to look into this, if I just knock off this term because the first term is same, I want to show that this guy is upper bound, this is a lower bound on this. So I am just rearranging these two things. So is it fine? Like I want to show this is the upper bound on this. I am just saying that is same as saying that I want to show that this guy. So if you just like rearranging these things. Okay, so we are going to prove this by induction. So t is running from 1 to n, right? So let us take n equals to 1 first round. Is this true for first round? Just by this argument, right? So in the first round, as soon as you get f1, you are going to choose w2, which is going to minimize this function f1. So for n equals to 1, you have f1 of w2, which is definitely going to be smaller than any point u. This is by the way you are choosing w2, okay. Okay, next we are going to select, assume that this inequality holds for n minus 1 rounds, and then we will show that it will also holds for the nth round, okay. So then it is like t equals to 1 to n minus 1. F t w t plus 1 less than or equals to t equals to n f of t of u. So notice that this u is any number in my S, but fixed right from the beginning, okay. Only this WTs are varying as per your algorithm. Okay, now what we'll do is I'm going to add on both sides. Okay, I'm just going to add this both terms. So if I add this both terms, this is going to be t equals to 1 to n f of t w t plus 1, like I add this and absorb it inside the summation, and this is going to be upper bounded by okay, I have just added, yeah. So this instead of n minus 1, I have written it n because this term is this one, this one. What you are saying, this should be. So as I said, this is, this u is arbitrary, right? Like this u is any u. So this particular u I have chosen, this holds for any u. So I am going to choose this u to be w n plus 1, that specific value chosen by that algorithm in the n plus 1th round. So if you do that, what is this going to be? F of n w n plus 1 plus t equals to 1 to n minus 1 f t w n plus 1. Right, I am doing this, this should hold because this is true for any u, and so for particular u equals to n plus 1. But now if you look into this, this is nothing but they will add up, but I do not want that. I want them to add up on w n plus 1. I want them to add up because I know how w1 plus 1 is selected. They are selected in a specific fashion, right? But u is just a fixed quantity for me, given thing. So I can still add up, right, with wn plus 1. But what is this by definition? This wn plus 1 is such that this is basically min over right, because wn plus was selected basically by minimizing this over all u, that is why this equality holds here. So what we have done, we have shown that this is upper bounded by the minimum of this. Are we done with this? So this is the minimum over all u, right? So if you take one particular u from this, it is going to dominate this. So I can now take that, like this is true, this is true. If you, whatever that initial u you started with, you just take it, it has to dominate this. So this is like any u, this is for any u. So recall that the way I am doing, I am first saying that this inequality holds for any u belong to S, okay, and now I am trying to do induction. When I came to this step, since this is true so far for any u, I took a specific u to be wn plus 1 and then I got on this, okay. But now this is the minimum over all u, so this should be, if you take up any particular u, this should be an upper bound. So what I have shown is now exactly what we wanted. So then all we need to prove any regret bounds, all we need to worry about is this upper bound. If we can give an upper bound on this quantity, we have an upper bound on also the regret. As if we can show an upper bound, see now this guy is no more specific on u. Now if I can bound this quantity, this will be a regret bound on this, and that is holds for any every all u. So that is what my regret definition was, okay. So all of you followed the steps here, okay. So only trick we used here is after adding this, we made sure that this guy is an, basically by choosing this u in a specific fashion, this becomes an actually this is this wn plus is coming by choosing this minimization problem like this by all the previous n ft functions, okay, fine, good. We have this bound expressed in this form now. Let's compute this, what happens for a specific convex function, okay. Earlier one possible convex function we have done is like some wt vt, okay, but I will not directly jump to this. Instead we will look into a quadratic loss function. So we are going to take a ft which is defined as so all of you understand what is this? This is a squared L2 norm, okay, and I have included this factor half there. So now let's try to compute what happens when my functions are FTs like this, okay. So in each round, what I'm going to do, I'm going to compute my WT to be argmin of my I equals to 1 to t minus 1, this quantity, right, half of w minus vt for w. Can somebody compute this quickly and tell me what is wt? This should be easy to compute, right? You can differentiate this, huh? No. You, how about W? We wrote, right, FTL algorithm. So how did it choose? Oh, W1. Okay, we are talking about W0. Yeah, you choose in any way you like. Okay, yeah, only we are only worried about subsequent ones. So this is, so and t equals to 1, I do not have anything to optimize here, I will choose w1 arbitrarily, but after t equals to 2, I am going to start optimizing. Yeah, which is going to be just the mean of all vt's, right. So wt is going to be so it should be vi here. Okay. Now, okay, so this is for wt. If you are interested in wt plus 1, it is just going to be like this. You are going to basically average first t terms for the wt plus 1th prediction. Now, this can be kind of just rewritten. So, you can go and verify that, you can rewrite it in terms of this. This is easy to observe, like you can split the summation over t minus 1 terms and the average of the first t minus terms is going to be wt and then the last term comes like this. You can just verify, this is just like manipulation. So, if you just add t minus 1 and then split this as so, you will just end up with this. Okay, now I want to further simplify this. So, if I am going to simplify this as minus pt, this term is going to be 1 minus 1 by 2 into wt minus vt. Okay, so basically what I did to come from here, from wt plus 1, I just subtract minus vt, you also subtract minus vt from here and you will have this 1 by 1 minus t common term and you will end up with this term. Okay, so now go back and plug this relation in what we are really interested in. I am going to take one specific term here, f of t wt minus f of t w t plus 1 here. Now, by definition, what is f of t wt? It is f of t computed at wt, right. This is nothing but already f of t of w, which is in this fashion. So, f of t wt is half of and the other quantity I am going to get so now what I will do is I have already expressed wt plus 1 minus vt in terms of wt minus vt. I am going to plug back that relation here from here, this quantity, and if I do this, I will end up half of 1 minus 1 by t whole square times okay. So is this correct? Like I have just substituted this by this quantity, and then I have just pulled out the common term Vt, Wt minus Vt whole square. Now if you just expand this square term here, this is going to be 1 plus 1 by t square minus 2t, 2 by t, and then if you knock off the one term here, what you will end up is f of Wt minus f of t w plus is equals to half of minus 1 by t square by 2 by t times the norm. Right, this is will be, this is a squared, right? So this will going to get 1 square plus 1 by t square. So we have substituted this entire thing here, right? Oh sorry, there is a minus here, right, which I made a mistake here. This minus I have to write here, not it was not plus. Is that correct now? Okay, now what I will do is I will ignore this 1 by t square term because that is having a negative sign. I will ignore that, then I am going to get an upper bound, and that is going to be, and this 2 knock off with this, I am going to get 1 by t times 1 by t minus Vt okay. So at this point let me make an assumption that this loss vector that has been chosen here. So here notice that the environment is choosing the loss vector Vt and I am defining the loss like this. So suppose assume that my loss vectors are all bounded, okay, by some number L, some number which I know and just a bound. So if you have this, you know that my Wt here is basically finding average of my Vt's, right? Wt plus 1, earlier we wrote this is nothing but the average of this Vt. So because of that, is it true that my Wt's will also satisfy this condition? If all my Vt's are upper bounded by this, because Wt's are nothing but just averages of these Vt's, they should also be satisfying this condition. Yeah, we can assume that, okay. Let us see, do I need to do this? This is starting from t equals to, okay, the only issue that comes is only time when W1 is coming is this point when t equals to 1, otherwise it is coming nowhere. So that is, you can always split this part for t equals to 1 and take the other part, okay. So you have separated that out. So let us not, so let us assume that t equals to 1 part we have ignored this, let us only focus on the other term now. But for all the other terms you agree that this holds, okay. Now if you now you have this, now you go and apply triangular inequality on this. If you go and apply triangular inequality on this, we are going to get, this is upper bounded as norm of Wt square plus norm of Vt square. That is one bound I can get. And I know that both of them are upper bounded by L, so I will end up with 1 by t times 2L. Now what I will do is I will take the summation on both sides. That is what finally what I am interested in is, right. So this is going to be what then? Summation t equals to 1 to n 1 by t 2 l. So, what is summation 1 by t from as t goes to 1 from n? What is the bound I can get on this? Log n. Why is that? Because integration of 1 by x is log x, right? And here we are doing discrete, but fine, I can make it continuous and get an upper bound. So, this is going to give me 2 l log n. So, now what I have is a bound which is independent of what was the u I am interested in. This is true for any u. So, finally, what I ended up showing is for the FTL algorithm, this is upper bounded by 2 l log n. So, l is some constant which I am assuming that is the bound on the norm of this WTs. So, now if you see that finally, what I am able to show that the regret of my follow the leader algorithm is upper bounded by so is this sublinear this regret? Yes, right. So if you are going to so we have shown that this follow the leader algorithm has this good regret bound which is order log n. Then the next question is fine, if you have taken a quadratic function like this you are able to get it, but is it true for any convex function or is it true that if it is true for any convex function, why didn't you consider this function and show that this also holds? Even if you have function like this, then also this bound holds. Okay, so we'll argue it in the next class that if you are going to just apply follow the leader algorithm in this fashion, when we have this linear functions like this, we may not end up with a bound like this. In fact, we may end up with a linear bound. Okay, so something more has to be done there. So for that, we will see that we have to kind of do a regularization on this. It is not that we should arbitrarily allow this W2s to change too much. We should not possibly allow them to change them too much. We should a bit slightly constrain them. Then we will show that if you can do that, then even for this linear case, we will end up achieving a good bound like this. And then we will show that any convex function which need not be just like linear like this, that can be translated to be a linear function. And then the regularized version of the follow the leader algorithm will give also good performance there. Okay, so let's do all this in the next class.